From downtown Lexington, Kentucky, this is Rupp Arena, and tonight it's a home SEC opener for the preseason favorites, the Kentucky Wildcats. The Aggies of Texas A&M are in town as these two teams meet for the 10th time as SEC opponents. And inside Rupp Arena, the first things that come to mind may be the 8 national championships, the 17 Final Fours, 10 Hall of Famers, including a Hall of Fame head coach, and his $2 billion of NBA contracts. But besides the banners in the rafters, besides the expensive seats courtside, the lifeblood of this program resides from every corner of the Commonwealth. And in Big Blue Nation, I have found the best way to experience Kentucky fans is to get with them and go to the upper deck of Rupp Arena. And here, the passion is obvious. I'm with Sally Donaldson. She's from Danville, Kentucky. She's been coming to games for a long time. Sally, it's a simple question. What do Kentucky fans expect?
A championship.
It's as simple as that. So down on the court, close to the action, is my partner, John Sumpold. The question all Kentucky fans have, Sonny, can this Kentucky team bring home another national title?
Well, first of all, my friend, you've never looked so good from such a far, long way away. Yes, this team can. And what has changed for this squad in the last month is the fact that Ashton Hagans has been playing outstanding defense. He is tough, he is disciplined, and he has brought leadership from the defensive side. Don't worry about the points, necessarily anything else. He is a disruptor. And if you're thinking about A&M, we know they've got a rebound when they come to this building. But most importantly, T.J. Starks has to have a performance. Freshman, he was on the All-SEC freshman team. But this is a guy that has to play ball. He's got to handle the basketball well. He's got to shoot it well. I've got a question. You know what? I've got a lot of room down here, Tom, and it's great to work. Are you heading down, or are you going to stay up?
I haven't decided. I got Mary, Rusty, Jana, and Joe. I got Chuck and Jim. It's my people. I might be the only one wearing cufflinks, but I might just stick around.
Well, have fun. Be careful. I'll handle it down here.
If I do make my way down, do you want some popcorn?
Bring me some, please. Light on the salt, extra butter. Great matchup. Kentucky will start man-to-man defensively. They have been good at times defensively against North Carolina and against Louisville. They were not good at Alabama. They allowed quick buckets. They allowed easy shots from the outside. Didn't get back defensively.
Sonny, it's a Kentucky team that doesn't guard behind the line very well. The good news in tonight's matchup is that Texas A&M is the worst three-point shooting team in the SEC. But you said this is a Kentucky team that can win a national title, and Ashton Hagans plays great defense. But who's got to be the best offensively for this Kentucky team to realize their potential?
Well, there's a mixture of guys, but the guy who stands brightest to me is Keldon Johnson. He's an outstanding shooter, outstanding scorer, shoots at a high percentage, 56%. He doesn't get enough shots, let's be blunt about it. If he scores the highest at 16 points a game and shoots 56%, get him some more looks, get him some more touches. This is a good offensive team, and at times they are explosive because of their speed and quickness. And solid defensively by Kentucky. Where does A&M go to get buckets? Talking to Billy Kennedy at shoot-around today, he said, you know, we have a young team, and at times they're even immature. They don't know where the shot should come from. And that's about leadership. And when you lose a guy like Admon Gilder, who will not play this season, and from last year gone is Robert Williams and Tyler Davis and DJ Hogue, it's a whole new squad for Billy Kennedy's team. Defensively, what is the signal and what has been the key for A&M and the history of Billy Kennedy? They're always good defensively. They block out. They're usually a great man-to-man team, although I think tonight we'll see some zone. We'll see some soft man. They'll try to make Kentucky beat him with jump shots.
Coming off of a Sweet 16 appearance last year, but they lost three key players that went on from A&M, only one of them playing in the NBA right now.
A&M historically has been good and patient on the offensive end. They do not want to get in the track meet, especially in Rupp. Off to a good start. Another jump shot, this one by Mitchell. And Wendell Mitchell is a guy that they expected big things from. Junior college player, but he got injured. Hurt his knee in the summertime. Had to sit out the first three games. Now he's back. Now he's healthier.
and he is starting to deliver.
Kelvin Johnson for three. And Reed Travis, who did not have a great second half against Alabama, doing what he has to do, fighting for a rebound.
You know, I'm impressed, partner, that you can talk and walk at the same time. What a good start for A&M, and the key that Billy Kennedy talked about to his team was we just make smart plays early. Let's get a couple buckets. Let's keep the home crowd at bay, especially early.
What's the point of Kentucky showing three-quarter court pressure?
Well, again, they just want to control tempo that Texas A&M doesn't get off to a start, especially by that guy. T.J. Starks is a guy that can explode by you. Tough to guard man-to-man. Tough to match up.
He had a great game against him last year in A&M's win in College Station against Kentucky.
Starks plays very much like Peters does from Mississippi State. Hard to stay in front of, left-handed, strong with the ball, physical.
A blitzing start for A&M, up by a touchdown, and defensive pressure. Starks ahead, and he threw it away.
And there's a mistake Starks can make. That's an easy pass. Make the pass. He's got equal number of assists to turnovers. Again, only a sophomore, had a terrific season last year. The mistakes last year was the fact that he made too many of those, too many turnovers.
And he's going to touch the ball a lot. 31% of their possessions end with the ball in T.J. Starks' hand.
And he has to, because he's explosive. And what A&M needs on the offensive end is guys that can make plays and guys that can score. You already mentioned, they only shoot 28% beyond the three-point line.
Kelvin Johnson again. And an offensive foul. A&M is up 7-0 in the first 3 minutes of this one with possession.
Let's go back to Billy Kennedy type team. They are always solid defensively, man-to-man defensively. They guard their guys. They're a good help side defense. And they normally rebound well. This is a different team. This is very young squad, new faces. Last year, a Sweet 16 team.
And a couple years before that, a Sweet 16 appearance when Kennedy was named the SEC Coach of the Year. A good drive, but they come up empty, and P.J. Washington with the board. Here's Tyler Hero. The lob, and Nick Richards wasn't expecting it. And a Kentucky turnover.
And always remember, rebounders expect shooters to shoot. He made a nice pass. Sure, it was unselfish play. But most rebounders are going to look like for Tyler Hero to shoot the basketball. He had a wide-open look.
And he's great in the mid-range.
Correct. That way he's a great shooter. He can finish at the rim, shoot it deep, shoot it mid-range. And when he pulls up, most rebounders are going to rebound.
Savion Flagg throws in a three.
He is coming off a game against Arkansas. He had 20 points and 15 rebounds. What a start for the Aggies.
My friends in the upper deck are not too happy right now, I guarantee you that.
I'm glad you made it down, partner.
Especially with the score the way it is. I couldn't have stayed.
Yeah, they won't let you beat that opening again here.
Here's Ashton Hagans for three. Good stroke, but back rimmed it. Off and running.
And what did Alabama do to the Kentucky team? They got out on the break and got open looks. A missed opportunity on the follow-up by Flagg.
Couple of missed chances for the Aggies. Hero, ball fake, corner three. Still nothing for Kentucky. Kelvin Johnson off the offensive board.
First thing anybody talks about Kentucky is the way they rebound. They're long, they're tall, they're athletic, but they are aggressive at attacking the basketball.
You mentioned getting back against A&M fast breaks. John Calipari over the last 2 days in practice has been stressing that. We've got to be able to run with anybody. We have to be able to get back. Shot clock's at 7.
And here's who needs to have the ball. Starks very good off the dribble and strong.
Wow.
And physical and can finish.
Reverse layup. A&M leads by 10. Starks has 4 early for the Aggies.
I mentioned in the opening, he was an all-freshman squad in the SEC last year, but he was so special in their run in the NCAA tournament.
Hero off-balance shot and a foul underneath, and that's going to go against Kentucky. What a start for the Aggies of Texas A&M, a 500 club coming in. But they're playing their best 5 minutes of the season thus far. Savion Flagg a three, T.J. Starks in reverse. It's all Aggies early.
4.3, two-point game. Hagans. Hero to win it. Alabama hangs on. And they beat Kentucky for the first time in 6 years.
And so Kentucky starts conference play with a loss that was on the road in Tuscaloosa on Saturday, a game that featured 9 ties and 10 lead changes after a bad second half against Alabama. And now Texas A&M.
Crowd quiet, and they've done that. They have handled the basketball. They've made open looks. And again, we've already talked about they're not a great shooting team, but if you give them paint touches and penetration, they're going to finish.
Billy Kennedy's squad has been depleted by departures and by injury, but TJ Starks had 17 points and 4 assists against Kentucky last year, and he has picked up where he left off. Aggies get it to Christian Mekawolu off of the carom. A&M has not worried about going inside just yet. They've got a little bit of size, but not much. Starks carried it right out of bounds.
Good active hands. I don't know if it was Hagans or Johnson to knock it off his leg.
Hagans has become a defensive specialist for John Calipari. He derives great confidence in that. And Nick Richards with the finish.
And Hagans can be explosive offensively and get to the paint. He's got to do those things and understand where he can make plays for his teammate off the dribble.
Brandon Mahan for 3. That one was halfway down. Christian Hagans, be free to be Steve Nash. Keep the ball in your hands until you find somebody open.
Keep the dribble alive. And he has 2 penetrations, 2 easy buckets set up to his teammate. This pass right on the money, easy finish.
A couple of subs coming in for A&M. Josh Nebo, transfer from St. Francis, Pennsylvania. Hagans hearing from John Calipari, and Nick Richards at the free throw line. Richards is an enigma for this Kentucky team. He's got NBA talent, and if he can execute plays, he can play a lot of minutes. If he won't, he'll be sitting next to John Calipari.
Last year, started every game, averaged 15 minutes a game. This season, only averaging 11 minutes a ball game.
We're waiting for him to blossom, but Reed Travis's struggles have equaled more minutes for Nick Richards over the last couple of games.
Good matchup, Hagans on Starks.
Wendell Mitchell nearly turned it over.
Mitchell's hit 1-3, solid shooter.
Flag tried to dish it, went off of Richards' hand. Out front, PJ Washington. And carried across the end line by Starks. It will stay with Kentucky.
Good hustle. Good hustle. Might not have gone your way, but Starks saved a layup. Good call. Checking up
for Kentucky is Emmanuel. Emmanuel quickly enters. Tyler Hero will take a seat, so in essence, 2 point guards on the floor for Kentucky with this lineup. Washington and Flagg will be an interesting defensive matchup tonight. Here's Johnson. A strip, but a whistle.
Nice curl by Johnson. Off the down screen instead of popping for the shot. Turned it in lane and could have made a play for himself or his teammate Richardson, Washington, who set the screen.
So here's Keldon Johnson, freshman out of Oak Hill High School. Had 23 in his Kentucky debut against Duke. He's a guy that could be good enough to carry him.
Yeah, and the most difficult thing about being in a team sport, Tom, is understanding, instead of worrying about yourself, how are your teammates playing? Who's good on my team and who's not playing well? And I say that because if you're a Kentucky player, Keldon Johnson's numbers stick out. The way he plays sticks out. He just doesn't get enough opportunities on the offensive end. If I'm a teammate, I try to get him going early because then that changes the makeup of how they are offensive and how other defensive teams have to play this Wildcat squad.
Second on Nick Richards, so he'll come out of the game. I love that point about Keldon Johnson, and some of that is on the teammates getting him involved. Some of that is on him forcing the issue and being more involved.
Yeah, and that's a tough thing when you're a young age, no matter, they're all young. But if you're the guy that can change a team offensively, how other squads have to guard you, then you make your plays.
Another free throw coming for Wendell Mitchell. Teammates call him Chuck. Started his career at Baylor, redshirted 1 year there, then 25 games 2 years ago before going the junior college route for a year. Now back in major conference basketball. He said, I can't wait to find out what the SEC is all about. I experienced the Big 12. I experienced Allen Fieldhouse. Now I get to come to Rupp.
How about that? Get to play in two of the great places in college basketball.
J.J. Chandler. Wild shot. Barely caught the rim.
You make a move in the lane, you got to turn your shoulders to the rim. Don't fade away, you'll be in trouble.
E.J. Montgomery, nice. Touch.
So the buckets for Kentucky, Tom, are all right now in the paint. They've been able to get to the rim, easy baskets. Aggies got to shore it up defensively.
This is a game that A&M led at one point, 10-0. Mitchell for three.
Got a great stroke, got a little bump out there, bumped the defender away.
He's got eight of the Aggies, 17. Kentucky has been torched by opposing three-point shooters multiple times this season. Whether it was Alabama, VMI, UNC Greensboro, that's their weakness. And E.J. Montgomery's got another bucket.
A&M offense is a little hesitant without a guy like Starks in the lineup to be able to push. Who can score? Flag can go inside, he can make outside shots, and we've seen Mitchell with a couple jumpers.
Stolen away. Here's Quickly.
Good hands, good steal, another easy bucket for the Wildcats.
Cats within one, and the Rupp faithful to their feet, including my buddies in section 230. Here's Savion Flagg. Blocked by Montgomery. Kelvin Johnson to Quickly. And the Cats have their first lead.
Tom, it's all been on the defensive end. Bad miscues by A&M, turnovers. But Kentucky has stepped up their defense a notch.
Kentucky on a 15-4 run. They have their first lead of the game, and the Aggies forced to use a timeout. The home opener for Kentucky after a slow start, and they've gotten it going.
Yeah, everything's at the rim. They've made six of their last seven. Four turnovers by A&M has led this Kentucky team not only to take the lead in this game, but to get the crowd involved. So everything from the defensive end, and Cal has talked about it since the loss to Alabama. They've got to be better defensively. They've got to be more aggressive. They've got to use their length, get in passing lanes, cause turnovers, and they've done that.
You know who's happy about this?
Who's that?
Sally Donaldson from Vanderbilt up there. Mary and Rusty, Jana and Joe, Brett and Wendy, even though Wendy didn't offer any of her ice cream to me. Kevin from Florence, Kentucky, with his wife, AD, is 43 years old. He's at his very first Kentucky game.
Come on.
He was supposed to come to one 20 years ago, but his brother lost his wallet and they had the tickets on him.
And they got to meet Tom Hart.
Well, take the good with the bad. Mitchell from the elbow. Playing with a lot of confidence. Reed Travis fighting for the rebound. Aggies have it. And they get a fresh 30, but then they turn it over. Quickly, another steal. Jamal Baker to Hero. Whoa, he got twisted around and still almost hit it. If that's on Starks, that's his second, and that's going to be an issue for an A&M team, which only has eight scholarship players.
Well, think of this. A&M's having a hard time getting back defensively with more than one guy. So if there's a turnover, there's got to be a dead sprint from the weak side guys. They can't allow Kentucky the rest of this half to continue just to push it and have good looks at the rim.
Tyler Hero from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Was originally headed to Wisconsin, committed to the Badgers. Guy scored 40 points eight times during his senior year of high school. The Boy Wonder nickname has been well earned. But they're still kind of waiting for Hero to blossom. He had 12 last time out.
Had a terrific afternoon in the victory against Louisville with 24. Made four threes in that game. Capable of big nights.
Oh, Mahan went down. Not much of an inside presence for Texas A&M tonight. That was a concern for Billy Kennedy against Kentucky size.
Yeah, the key is, though, they've got to keep good spacing that allows some of their cutters good cuts, but Kentucky has been so good now on the defensive end.
Here's Hero trying to win the foot race, and he gets fouled from behind and will go right back to the free throw line. Josh Nebo commits the foul.
Active hands, and again, shot clock running down and no teammates open. Another break, another chance for Hero to go to the free throw line.
You know, challenging a breakaway has almost become an art defensively in this day and age because it seems like the guys in stripes are anxious to give you a flagrant foul.
Well, the key obviously is to make a play on the ball, but still referees get that judgment to say, is it excessive? And if they determine it would be, then you're a flagrant one. The tough part for a defender is you don't want to get dunked on, correct?
Correct.
So you would challenge if you're at the size to be able to challenge. And would you rather have a flagrant one or be dunked on? That'd be my question to any athlete. And most would say, I'll take the flagrant one.
Yes. It's a 10-0 run for Kentucky right now. Elsewhere in the SEC, number 3 Tennessee on the road. Trails Missouri 17-10 early on. In Missouri,
tough shot by Starks, and he doesn't get back defensively. That puts you outside of balance on a defensive end, and Kentucky is starting to make A&M pay.
Hero strokes a three. It's a 13-0 Kentucky run. They were once down 10-0. Now they're up by 8. Biggins.
Again, because Starks doesn't run back, they do not, they're off balance on the defensive end. And when Hero gets it going, it changes how Kentucky plays on the offensive end. It stretches the defensive team.
Hero scored the last 7 for Kentucky. Significant minutes for Jamal Baker here in the first half tonight. He got the ultimate directive from his coach when he first played. John Calipari said, you're in the game to shoot. Don't hesitate. I want you to shoot. Here's Starks playing with 2 fouls and way off the mark with that 3. Montgomery took a bump. What has changed for Texas A&M offensively since the early spurt?
Well, they got stagnant, and when you get stagnant and then get no stops on the other end, this is the first time that's 2 possessions they got to push the ball up because they finally got a stop against Kentucky. If you're stagnant against an active Kentucky defense that's long, if you don't move and make hard cuts, you're going to be in for a long night.
Quickly from behind the screen.
You mentioned it, Starks has 2 fouls. Hard for him to be aggressive. Double dribble.
Starks looks at the official in disbelief. Everything's going wrong.
He took the ball 2 hands and caught it with 2 hands. Made a hard bounce. Turnover. Wildcats on a roll.
Is rolling early. Missouri is up on Tennessee. 9 minutes to go in the first half. Alabama and LSU are next. And a really big one for Mississippi State on ESPNU later tonight. See if Ben Hallen's team can keep it rolling on the road.
Outstanding team. They've got good depth. They've got good players. They're explosive. But traveling to South Carolina is never easy when you get into conference play, and you got to see South Carolina with that big win against Florida.
It was a surprising victory for a very talented but young Florida team. For head coach Mike White, Tyler Hero missed the 3. We'll have him next week on Tuesday night. Florida goes to Mississippi State. That'll be a heavyweight matchup in Starkville. Keldon Johnson. Tyler Hero, no.
Matchup zone defense by Billy Kennedy's squad. He is not known to play a lot of zone, but they worked on it today. They don't have a lot of bodies. They've got to protect some with foul problems. Also try to make Kentucky make jump shots.
And his concern is his bigs, including Christian Mekawolu, trying to block out inside. T.J. Stark says, don't worry about it. I'll just make the jumper. He's got 9.
You almost have to keep it in Stark's hands if you're A&M. Let him make plays. See if he can create for himself or his teammates.
A&M came in 336th in the country in 3-point percentage. They have hit 3 of 5 so far tonight. It is a common theme against Kentucky this season, and one that is a head-scratcher.
Almost crazy, isn't it?
Yeah.
Alabama made 10 threes in that ball game in their win against Kentucky.
Loose ball rebound corralled by John Walker III. He's a redshirt freshman. Brand new look for this Texas A&M team. Admon Gilder out, as you mentioned. Robert Williams now with the Celtics. Tyler Davis and DJ Hogarth gone. And here's quickly again. Carmen Higgins hangs and hits. And Ashton Higgins with a chance for a three-point play.
You lose the ball out front, you get it taken away, and you got bad numbers coming back. Higgins is a solid defensive. Stays down, stays low, plays the bounce. Good finish.
I was talking with John Calipari about Ashton Higgins' confidence. I said, you know, I haven't seen your team in a couple of weeks, but you can immediately notice when you walk in the gym that Ashton Higgins is playing with his chest out, his shoulders back. And he said, well, it all comes from defense. Because if you can't play defense, how can you be confident? If you're getting punked on the offensive end, you're getting embarrassed. It's almost impossible to be confident. But if you have it the other way like he did and tied a school record with 8 steals against North Carolina, that just breeds confidence on the other end of the floor.
It does, and it's rare, though, that the kids nowadays do it on the defensive end.
Yeah, and that's now, here he is again.
And that's his identity, and he has changed the way Kentucky has played and the way they're looked at.
They're going to get Chuck Miller, Mitchell for the personal foul, and they're going to say it's intentional. And we got more action and plenty of whistles. And Walker will be held back. Mekawulu was in that, and we're going to have to figure out all the combatants. I think we got Wendell Mitchell for the first personal, and he said it shouldn't be intentional. I was going for the ball. Remember, collaborative replay, the officials will put the headset on if they need be, and they'll get help from Birmingham. I think he had a point up until he held the bicep.
Yeah, correct. What's interesting besides that play, which they'll look at, is Mekawulu was the one who was so upset. So something must have happened away from the basketball. Inside between Mekawulu and one of the Kentucky players. You see, I think it's okay as a play. You're just not letting the guy extend and go up. Doesn't mean they can't give him a flagrant foul. I wouldn't call it that.
A&M took its largest lead of the game at 12-2. And then Kentucky went on the run. It was so quiet in here, you could hear a nose whistle. Here's another look, another steal for Higgins. Do you agree that Mitchell was going after the ball early, but holding on to him in this day and age will bring a flagrant?
Yes, but you have to hold on, or else he gets the ball and lays it in. If you don't hold on, he'll finish the play. I don't think it was flagrant enough to where he was trying to hurt or do anything to make it a disadvantage. I think he fouled hard. I think he held on so that the shot does not go to the rim. That's what you're taught. There's the foul, and you hold on basically so he doesn't lay it in.
Yeah.
Because if it's a hard contact, he's still going to finish the play with a layup.
And then it continued.
I think it's more curious is what happened after the play, and it wasn't those guys. It was right in here. Mekawulu came in. I mean, he was upset that some stuff had happened.
John Walker got into it. I'm not surprised that Keldon Johnson, who's got an oversized personality, was maybe involved at the very beginning. And this SEC crew, Pat Adams, veteran official, has a headset on along with Michael Roberts and Ron Gruber trying to sort everything out. Remember, mentioned this a moment ago, collaborative replay, which means he's on the headset with the folks back at the video center in Birmingham getting help trying to filter through some things. It's not perfect, but it's an extra set of eyes and ears.
Yeah, I think the collaborative would be just come over here and ask us.
Yeah.
That would be collaborative.
I think more people should ask
it.
What we think.
Yeah, we've
seen about everything.
We got screens around us.
I've got plenty of opinions.
It would advance time, right? We'd get to play.
Uh-huh. And how accountable would we be held?
We'd be good.
We would be good. I had a great time up in Section 230, by the way, except for Wendy, who refused to bring me any ice cream. She said if I were Jay Billis, she would have brought me ice cream. I said Jay Billis would never be in the upper deck, Wendy. And Carol Fritz, who has her dad's season tickets, has been in the upper deck of RUP since day one. Here's the continuation.
21, Mekawulu.
So they might be checking all of those things. And they might be seeing if anything really happened. Which there were no punches thrown or just a little communication, a couple love taps between big guys. That's always okay. Play on. At some point, play on, right?
Yeah, I mean, eventually, but it gives me a chance to continue my roster, right? Shirley Daniel, Caroline Gunter, both here for the very first game at Rupp Arena. It brought a sign and everything.
So when it got a little smoky, we could barely see it, right?
That was my best side.
We didn't anticipate the smoke. But she did look good. It was a long ways up.
It has filled in since I was up there. I noticed that once I left, a lot more people wanted to come to those seats. We'll get an explanation here on what we got officially. We got four technical fouls and a flagrant foul. Now,
they got all of that from that.
Yeah, they did.
Four technical fouls.
And now the technical fouls are relevant because those are personal fouls, but they cross each other out.
Cancel it all out.
It's like ninth grade algebra. So those cancel out, so no free throws for there, but free throws on the flagrant on Wendell Mitchell. And they're explaining it all with the numbers, and we're not exactly sure who all the technicals were on. P.J. Washington won, Keldon Johnson won, which would be his second.
I'm guessing John Walker from A&M along with Mekawulu.
Yes, he did say 21, so Mekawulu would be one of them. There's a lot of paperwork that Pat Adams is going to have to fill out after this game. Why, let me ask you, why the double technicals? Why is that necessary?
Setting the tone. Let's just say that.
Okay,
setting the tone.
You're an old school guy.
You played
almost a decade in the NBA. You played your college ball in the late 80s. This was like a Tuesday night at the rec center.
Yeah, it's love taps and communication. So now we've got four technicals that all cancel each other.
Okay, we change it. Your two technicals on A&M, one on Kentucky. So we'll get all the numbers and sort them out. But if that's important, because I think that would take one away from Keldon Johnson.
But back to your question, Tom. What we've just done is stayed 5 minutes on a relative semi-hard foul on the left. Semi-hard.
If
you just grabbed the arm. It wasn't semi-hard. Let's say this. Let's say you're a coach.
Okay.
And your player on defense is running back. Guy's got a layup attempt. You expect your defensive player as a coach to make a decently hard foul.
You're trying to keep him from scoring.
Correct. And if I make a slap at the ball and hit the arm and then don't continue to hold the arm and the guy finishes the bucket, okay, you're the coach. What are you doing with your guy that ran back?
Got to coach him up.
Yeah.
Play harder.
And you might take him out.
Hagans knocks down the free throws. The best I can tell, John Walker and Mekawulu picked up the technicals for A&M and P.J. Washington for Kentucky. Does that sound
makes
right?
Makes sense.
The worst thing about it, the good thing you're not Andy Kennedy, because if A.K. was sitting here doing the game, it would just cut into his time at Rosebud.
Well, I believe Mekawulu was going after P.J. Washington. Something happened.
It'd be interesting to see or hear what he heard from either P.J. Washington or Keldon Johnson got him so fired up.
And the great part for Hagans is he got to go shoot four free throws and have four quick points.
Yeah.
And now players got to get loosened up. It was almost like a full halftime we just had. It's a period in hockey, right? First period ended, now we'll play another one.
Good. At least next time we have this Bring Red Panda out and entertain us. Keldon Johnson off the glass.
Well, A&M is in trouble. They're not guarding defensively. Kentucky scoring everything they want is inside, around the rim.
Kentucky up by two touchdowns in this one. Did you enjoy the football game last night?
Part of it, yeah. Got a little long at the end. You know, it was good. We had fun. I think we were all surprised by the number.
Yeah, we weren't the only ones. J.J. Chandler walked with it. Another Texas A&M turnover. Speaking of football, how about Benny Snell? Snell, yeah. School record for rushing yards in the bowl game in the win against Penn State.
That looks like he's on at the draft already. Right? Well, he's answering the phone from the Raiders or somebody.
He and guys like Josh Allen better get used to that.
Yep.
They've got, I heard last night, I think the third most invites to the NFL Combine behind Alabama and Clemson.
And
tied for the third most.
And you just said that about Kentucky football.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. What they've done here, the excitement that they built around SEC, great season.
Mark Stoops and company with a 10-win season later on will tell you how it goes hand-in-hand with Kentucky's success on the hardwood. Here's Mitchell for three. Got it. Wendell Mitchell, who wants to be a professional bass fisherman when he graduates.
I love that.
He said the only thing he doesn't do is bring a collapsible rod on the road, but he keeps one in his car. He is want to just pull over and dip the line in. He said, I'm a southern guy, so I prefer fishing in grass. All Texas people do. Back east, you might prefer rock, but I'm a grass guy. Started at Baylor and now at Texas A&M after a stopover at Trinity Valley Community College. You know, Jordan Lee is a two-time Bassmaster champion. And rare to have back-to-back wins, the Bassmaster Classic. That's a lot of cash.
Got to be a few fishing holes around College Station. Oh, Brian in there.
Indeed. Tyler Hero for three. It's his second triple. Kentucky's run continues. Hero already into double figures.
Aggies went to a zone, and Hero started hopping around like, okay, when's it coming my way?
Yeah. And so Mitchell feels when the fish are biting, right?
Yep, same thing.
Savion Flagg off of his knee. Kentucky by 14, 11 turnovers for Texas A&M. And boy wonder, Tyler Hero starting to feel his stroke.
Not to trip. I wanted it in his mind to see if he could handle the pressure of Rupp Arena, that he wouldn't slide down the steps. So I did say it about five times. Make sure you don't slide.
They've got handrails, which was good. I met so many great people up there. I gave consideration to staying.
Outstanding work, partner.
You know, they got barbecue nachos right outside that vomitorium. I almost picked up two trays.
I was thinking they wouldn't let you back down.
Well,
where's your ticket, sir?
The blue coats are very thorough. I greased the guy, palmed him a 20, and I walked right down. There's a great story. I think Kyle Tucker wrote it for The Athletic about the history of the blue coats, who began as a booster organization back in the day. And it's a fantastic read and talks about their history and importance to this program. Here's Reed Travis trying to muscle it inside. Coming off of a off half for him against Alabama. I asked Reed today how he recovers from a bad day of basketball. He goes, I just shut it down. Take a break. Mitchell for three.
Yo, Mitchell.
And John Calipari actually kicked Reed out of the gym yesterday after practice. He said, I know you want to work.
Yep.
I know you want to do your routine, but you need a break. Just go.
The warfare of an athlete mentally, right?
Yeah.
That's the tough part. The other night at Nashville, I had Ole Miss at Vandy. Terrence Davis, an outstanding player, had two fouls early in the first half, didn't have a good half, had two fouls early in the second half. But Terrence Davis mentally somehow hung in there and then carried Ole Miss to a win down the stretch. But the hardest thing about most athletically is they're all gifted. How do you handle when things aren't going your way?
Reed Travis steps through the jam. Well, that'll help.
Nice pass, nice play, good patience. The tough part is always there's a negative feel when you haven't done something very well,
mm-hmm.
whether it's shooting, whether it's anything to do with basketball. If you're struggling guarding guys, you think about it too much, and all of a sudden you're making dumb plays defensively.
Nice shot. J.J. Chandler has his second bucket. Tyler Hero off the screen. There's Savion Flagg trying to wrap it around, and Reed Travis finds it. Saturday, more men's college basketball on the SEC Network. Vandy and Kentucky match up at 8:30 right here at Rupp Arena. Wildcats have won 7 of 8 against the Commodores.
Checking in for Kentucky is Nick Richards.
Out Emmanuel quickly at the free throw line. Mahan returns. Mitchell will get a breather, and Emmanuel quickly already made a three tonight. 50% over his last few games from behind the arc. So after a slow start, Kentucky has put it together, and A&M's made 5 of 6, but they've been bedeviled by their turnovers. Lob and great finish.
Yeah, nice backdoor cut. No communication by Kentucky on the defensive side there, but a good bucket. Gets them within, you know, if they keep within 10, it'll be pretty good for the end of this half.
That would keep them within striking distance, that's for sure. Here's quickly. Cut through to Baker. Got challenged on the three, and he made it. J.J. Starks commits his third foul here at the end of the first half, and Baker will have a chance for a four-point play. And the 4 points pale in comparison to Starks picking up his third.
Did you say something about just shoot it when you're in?
Just shoot it.
Find a spot, find an opening. Get a good look. Challenged. Tough bucket.
Jamal Baker didn't play at all last year. His freshman season at Menifee, California. Starks will sit for the rest. Barely practiced throughout the fall and finally got into action in December. And he is the offensive threat that this Kentucky team loves to have coming off the bench. Zach Calipari said it's really started with his defense. He's given us extra effort on the defensive end. Mitchell got a half step on the dish and the jam. Johnson Nebo.
Tom, a couple, that was a big possession. And really, A&M needs to stop to end this half.
In Columbia, Missouri, Tennessee leads Mizzou by 10 as that first half nears a close. Both favorites have come back after trailing early tonight in SEC play. Loose ball. A&M's got it. Out front, here's Flagg. And the jam. Savion Flagg drops it down. 10-point game. And then Hagen's fouled at midcourt. Backcourt foul trouble for A&M. Second on Chandler.
And it keeps A&M, obviously, this steal. And the finish keeps it within 10. But you can't make a foul late in a half like this one.
So here's Ashton Hagens. Hagens was a really good youth football player. He told me today that he quit playing football because, A, his basketball talents were beginning to blossom. And as a starting quarterback, they told him, you know what, we want you to sit behind somebody else. It just so happens that that Clemson quarterback won a national title last night, played in a lot of the same leagues that Hagens did. They played all-star basketball together at one point. Trevor Lawrence.
He had a pretty good night.
He did have a good night, both from the suburbs of Atlanta, with 4 on the clock into the corner. And a fight for the rebound. That's how the first half will end. Nearly a tip-in at the buzzer. Kentucky with a 12-point lead at the half after they trailed 10-0. John Calipari is standing by with John Stumble.
Coach, what do you think? First of all, slow start, but your guys made quick adjustments.
Execution at the beginning of what we were trying to do. Guys broke it off and did their own thing. We had a couple guys in our passing. I went to Jamal Baker. He passed. He passed. And we went on a 10. He passed. Not tried to shoot it. And then he still scored. We're fighting it. You know, we're missing one footer still. Can't miss that many.
Anything different defensively second half? Because really the last 15 minutes was pretty solid.
Yeah, our game plan is to go over pick and roll. So every three they made, we went under. And we're like, why did you do it? Why? I've been humming. We're going over pick and rolls, but let's just see how it plays out.
Get it fixed.
He passed. Sonny, he passed, he passed, he passed. And with that.
I can't pull out the pockets. A
little fancy action at the half tonight. It's like John Sundvold in his old shooting clinics. Although I haven't seen her shoot yet. 46-34 at the half. At Rupp Arena, sitting courtside alongside John Sundvold, I'm Tom Hart. Well, it was a 10-0 start for Texas A&M. You got the feeling that this Kentucky team was back on its heels, and they answered with a flurry of blows to reclaim the lead and take control.
Yeah, they answered on the defensive end, and if you're Texas A&M, they had 12 turnovers. And there's a difference between turnovers that you throw in the stands and those that you force and throw to the opponent. 7 steals by this Kentucky team in the first half. They went on a 15-4 run, and these steals led to easy buckets. They had 20 points in the paint. That got Kentucky going, but I will say this. A&M did answer at the end to get this within reason. A massive difference at the free throw line.
Those are the numbers in the first half. By the way, that was Hoops Green, who played at UTEP, who's from Lexington, out there doing her thing with the Globetrotters. Class starts tomorrow at Kentucky. Students back in full force. I would show up that first day to get that piece of paper that you needed. They gave you the schedule for the entire year.
And then you were good?
See y'all in a few. Yeah.
Oh, I heard you were a great student.
That might be the funniest thing I've heard tonight. Scouting report may have been wrong. Here's Tyler Hero. The lob. And he's knocked away. Jack Calipari told you going into break that they're not defending the three correctly. They want to go over the screens. They're going under the screens. And it's been an issue for Kentucky all season long. And we get a foul as Mekwolu tried to take it inside.
And when they go over, again, they are a long team. So the guy setting the screen can help you out. You can defend better. If you go underneath, you give at least any guys who are good shooters. If you think of A&M, Mitchell's a good outside shooter, and Starks, it gets them confidence because that screen then can reset just a bit lower, gives you some open looks.
Christian Mekwolu played in the Ohio Valley Conference last year. He was the defensive player of the year in the league and second team all-conference. Had a great game against Mo Bamba. Had 15 and 11 against the first rounder who was at Texas at the time. A couple of blocks and 3 steals in that one.
He has got a solid stroke, 80% from the foul line. He has made 5 threes on the season. Doesn't shoot a lot. You can tell his stroke there.
Shot clock at 8. Tyler Hero lobs it to Johnson. And he'll yank. Hero with the offensive board. John Calipari with a play from the sideline. Let's see what they draw up.
Tom, remember really the first half. They didn't have a lot of buckets in the half court set.
Yeah.
Most of it was on breaks. Breakdowns defensively. They got to the rim, got to the paint. If A&M can shore up themselves defensively and make Kentucky make jump shots or make shots with a hand in their face, changes the game.
Well, number one, A&M's got to cut back on the turnovers after 12 of them in the first half.
They ask a lot from TJ Starks, only a sophomore, but he's going to have to be able to deliver with the team they have.
The lefty Chandler banks it in. Kentucky faithful Getting a little nervous here as A&M gets off to a good start. Hero high off the window.
It's a heck of a shot. High degree of difficulty.
And with his left.
Butt taken with confidence.
Starks
Now he is left-handed, but still. Anything you can do, I can do better.
You see T.J. Starks is the kind of player that would love to get in a shooting contest and just go mano-a-mano.
He pretty much goes mano-a-mano. Most every game you watch him play, he's going to, at some point in the game, he's going to go all by himself.
Hero.
He's got such good elevation to his jump shot. And most good jump shooters, the last bounce, his harder bounce, would get you into that shot, get you into the elevation. What great hands.
Hagans.
Wow.
It'll be Kentucky basketball. Not just good hands. They're huge hands. He's my height. Shook his hands and went all the way up my forearm. That's Hero with the jumper.
This is a tough one. He's right-handed going to his left. Obviously, everybody learns to make layups both ways, but that's more of a hook and high off the window. But Hagans' hands are so quick. Much like any player that's good stealing the basketball, they have strong, quick hands.
Mm-hmm.
Matchup zone. Hero's going to find some space, and he doesn't need much.
Line look to Johnson in the corner. An air ball, but Reed Travis is there. Travis did not start the second half. It came in early for Richards.
Now, that was an odd air ball, and I say that he might not have had his hands on it properly, might have slipped, but most good shooters aren't going to shoot a shot like that. An air ball and you're a good shooter, something happened, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's just not normal. And most of the time, a guy like that maybe just didn't have a hold of it.
Hero tried to lob it, and there's a foul on the way up for Kelvin Johnson.
The value of having a guy that can come off a screen and shoot it like Hero is the fact that he can then either pop out to shoot or curl it like he did, and he's gotten so much more confident as the season goes on, and he will. As a scorer, he turns the corner, puts it on the floor. So now he's got a lob, he's got a little jump hook, because he's got good size. He goes 6'5", he goes to the middle. He can easily finish the play by himself.
Hagan's jumper is good. A moment ago, they get the foul on J.J. Chandler. It was his third. And just like that, the Kentucky lead is up to two touchdowns.
How about Hagan's and his confidence? Yeah. What has happened in the last month and a half?
The great ones hit a spurt when it comes to just their basketball ability, and that goes hand in hand with the confidence.
And early on, there's wear and tear. It's a rude awakening to college basketball, right? How hard it is and the difficulty. But what's demanded at Kentucky is that you perform if you're one of those guys that can.
J.J. Chandler, redshirt sophomore out of Katy, Texas, with another free throw coming. E.J. Montgomery replaces P.J. Washington. Tennessee leads Missouri by 12 in Columbia, the third-ranked team in the country. Demolished Georgia. They're likely going to start SEC play 2-0. Would they be your favorites to win the whole thing?
Yeah, they would be. The only thing they don't have that can hurt them once in a while, they don't have a fierce shooter outside.
Mm-hmm.
Schofield can make shots, and when he makes shots, they almost are unbeatable outside, I'm saying. Bone can make open jump shots, but that's not any of their strength, but they are awfully good.
Jamal Baker charged with the foul. It's a 10-point game. A&M going to the free throw line. Aggies hanging right there. J.J. Chandler will be at the line when we return. A soon-to-be superstar who's already maybe the most popular guy in the state, and that's saying something. That's Benny Snell, all-time leading rusher in Kentucky football history. So when Kentucky football has 10 or more wins, what happens on the hardwood? Well, we'll wait and see how this John Calipari team answers. But Art Still's team back in 77-78, 10-1, won the national title 78. Go back to 1950-51, 11 wins, and won the national title in 1951.
How about that? I see the picture of Jack Gibbons cutting down the net, 78. He was in the building earlier today.
Usually is. Look at these two greats. Yep. Dan Issel alongside Benny Snell.
One of the all-time greats, Hall of Famer Dan Issel, over 27,000 points in his career.
That is really cool. They have a promotion in here with a pizza joint called the Hunk Cam, and they just put Dan Issel and Benny Snell on the Hunk Cam.
How great is that?
If when Dan Issel is taking your picture, you're a big deal. How awesome is that?
You know, Dan Issel played, obviously, here at Kentucky, and then was part of the Kentucky Colonels, the old ABA, but he was one of those greats that got to when the merger ABA-NBA happened, and he was with Denver then. Amazing things with Julius Erving and Artis Gilmore and Louis Dampier. And Dan Issel got to, all of a sudden, they're part of the NBA.
J.J. Chandler at the free throw line for Texas A&M. So many greats that have played within this Kentucky program.
And back, these young players wouldn't know it, but back when Dan Issel played and he was a freshman, he didn't get to play.
Yep.
He only had three seasons. Freshman ineligible back then.
Hagen's off the mark. It was actually 47 years ago yesterday that the NCAA repealed that. Does that sound about right? 40 years ago, 47?
I'll trust you. Let's put that.
Yeah. Tell me I'm wrong. Starks thought he got fouled. And he's holding his right forearm. Billy Kennedy's wondering where the whistle was. Baker, no. And the rebound, but a foul on it. And TJ Starks, after this, injured his right arm.
Wanted a call, I think a good non-call. The only way he might have gotten that foul is if he turned his whole body into the body of Montgomery. Looks to be okay now.
Do you think it'll stop him from shooting?
No, because it was his right hand. And, you know, I played for a coach that would have said, hey, you hurt your hand, but you didn't hurt either leg. You probably could have gotten up and ran back. But you got to lead in all areas.
14th turnover for Texas A&M. Reed Travis getting deep position. And it got blocked by Mekawolu and tracked down by his teammate. Up ahead, Chandler.
Chandler's had a couple runouts. And Mekawolu, you mentioned Defensive Player of the Year. Transferred in. Tennessee State. It was an outstanding block.
He had foul trouble in their Arkansas game. The SEC opener picked up his second personal foul just 5 minutes in.
You got to have a presence inside. In the last few years, they've had that with Robert Williams and Tyler Davis.
Two of the best in the league. Shot clock's at six. P.J. Washington with a quick turn. Followed his own miss. That's his first bucket.
John Calipari simply says, when you ask him about P.J. Washington, I want him to be more dominant.
Tough shot.
Yep.
Back-to-back buckets for P.J. Washington. And the thing is, he can be dominant.
Yeah, he can. He's shown it. 29-12 against Seton Hall. 19-18 against VMI.
Flag over Travis. A&M holds on to it. Mitchell is hunting for the foul. And then we get a whistle inside. Go against Baker, I believe. Coming up tonight, the SEC Now team will be back after Alabama LSU with all the college basketball scores, highlights, and analysis. Peter Burns, Pat Bradley, Pat Bradley's handkerchief, and more. You can also see it live on the ESPN app, as always. Might be still talking a little bit of football from late last night. We had a great time at KS Bar watching the first half of that one.
A lot of fun, a lot of activity, a lot of surprise faces. Alabama obviously didn't play their best game. A lot of mistakes at times.
Matt Adams has a headset on. They're going to review something else.
If they come over here with three technicals,
you're just gonna leave. Kevin from Florence, Kentucky, going to his first ever Kentucky game, is thinking, why do they have to stop the game so often? They're watching underneath Mekawolu. That's a hook and hold, maybe on Jamal Baker.
I get it. Yeah. Yep.
Hook and hold is the hot topic in college basketball these days.
Yep.
And it is something they want to take out of the game.
Well, with injuries that have happened over the years, that's what the call is going to be. There's the hook and hold, and we've had shoulder injuries, we've had different things.
Here's my question.
It's a focal point.
If it's been drilled into these players not to hook and hold, that you're going to get a flagrant foul if you do, and if you take the guy to the floor, you might get ejected from the game. Why does it still occur? Because it's something that you obviously have chosen to do.
So you're asking me why they would do it if they had a hook going on.
It's been elevated to a flagrant one, which is common with this foul. But I guess my question is,
so I'll just say
it's a focal point. You're going to get caught. Why has it even been taught anymore?
Well, it's probably not taught. It's just the fact that it happens, and you don't know to release. You know what I mean? When you're playing a game, and once it happens, you're probably not thinking. The other part is you're talking about 20-year-old kids. You are 20, and your kids aren't yet 20. I've had a couple that have hit 20 and beyond. Attention spans don't last that long. So even if you drilled it in practice, you can't do this, it's still going to happen.
I don't remember my 20s, mostly.
I can't wait till your kids get to 20.
I can. They'll be selling Girl Scout cookies. Wendell Mitchell.
You know, the hard part about some of the rules, the new rules, the emphasis. Most of the crowds do not know those rules.
Correct.
So they don't agree when there's a flagrant one and someone's shooting free throws. And to them, not much happened. What's amazing is A&M is within striking distance. Couple stops, couple threes. Again, they are under 10, and that is a key number.
And they've shown to be more potent offensively tonight, really, than they have all season. Travis with the handoff. And you're Billy Kennedy, you tell your guys, we can just get a couple of stops and not turn the ball over.
Yeah.
Said A&M with the foul on the Kentucky drive.
Good move by Keldon Johnson. When you're a little bit out of position, he's quick enough just to explode by you, and then there's too much pressure on the backside. You remember when you told me first half that Tennessee was up 10?
Yes.
On the road, hostile environment, Tennessee, Missouri.
And Missouri was up 10.
Missouri was up 10. Kind of bad blood between those two schools. The women's team just upset Tennessee. In Knoxville, football teams had a lot of success. The Vols are now up 19.
That's a really, really good Tennessee team.
Yes, they're good. Amazing what Rick Barnes has done in a few short years, right?
Keep winning. He's going to pop another cheer wine. Hickory, North Carolina native. Mitchell, after a lot of attention and a nice dump off and a finish by John Walker III.
So Mitchell has showed you ability to make jump shots, now off the dribble to get to the paint, create a play for a teammate.
Baker to Travis, knocked away. Good defense by John Walker with the denial. Mitchell threw it away. It is a 9-point game. The Aggies of Texas A&M hanging in, trying to find a win in Rupp. Kentucky getting all it can handle from Texas A&M. This A&M team, 4 of 9 from three. It's not a lot of threes, but 44% continues a disturbing trend for Kentucky, and that they have had a hard time slowing down other opponents from behind the arc. It happened with VMI. It happened with UNC Greensboro. Bubba Parham of VMI went 10 of 16 from three. Miles Powell of Seton Hall hit 6 threes. Kevin Mack hit 6 of 8 last time out. So they have let opponents have some field days. Tom Hart alongside John Sunbull, courtside here at Rupp Arena. Always great to be in Lexington. I think it goes back to what you talked about. Sometimes 19, 20-year-olds just kind of forget that we're supposed to go over the screen.
Forget from the afternoon when you do shoot-around to game time. But what's interesting, when you take an A&M team that doesn't shoot well, you wouldn't think, no matter if you go underneath or over the top, they're probably not going to shoot well. But it happens, and guys get on a roll, and you can't really describe why Kentucky has struggled with it.
And some on the staff even wonder. They go, you know, we can't figure it out. Just seems like guys hit one or two and then get this incredible confidence. John Calipari called it beer muscles. And all of a sudden, beer goggles. And next thing you know, the opponent's having a monster night. Rebounded by Mekawolu. And A&M trailing by 9, trying to find a smart decision to get a big bucket.
Starks cannot get loose with the ball. He's very good with it, but he can't get loose with it. But Tufty will pick it off and go the other way. Tough shot.
Wow! Did he bank that in? Did
no.
that go off the glass? Did that go off the corner of the glass?
No, I don't think it did.
I might be seeing
He didn't act like he did, although he's got a big smile on his face.
That might be crazy.
Matchup zone, good hands by Starks. Tried to bounce it through. Numbers.
Got Mahan on the wing.
Should have banked that.
Hero lost the handle. And they'll say it was off of A&M to the dismay of TJ Starks. How about that? On the entry pass, Mekawolu left his feet to get it in the corner.
Tough shot, couldn't tell if it banked, but I don't think it did, partner.
I saw the backboard shaking after it. Maybe it was a camera that was swinging back and forth. I do have a better view than the folks in section 230, though, so I shouldn't make a mistake like that. Hero back cut. Beautiful move.
Yep. Mahan fell asleep a bit into the weak side, late getting there.
P.J. Washington with the assist. And one coming for T.J. Starks.
Amazing how ball goes in the basket sometimes. I mean, there was no shot there, no room. He's powerful, he's got big shoulders, and look at this, between two big guys and then around and over and just crawls over the front of that rim.
Josh Nebo returns for Texas A&M. T.J. Starks at the free throw line. Starks, sophomore from Dallas. Only returning starter for an A&M team that made a Sweet 16 run last year. One of 8 SEC teams that made it into the NCAA tournament. Higgins dishes, Travis dunks. They go together like Daryl and Brianna. And Travis has a half dozen, and then A&M almost turned it over.
What happened in the first half was the fact that A&M did not stop dribble penetration. Same thing there. Good move by Higgins. Easy bucket. And Reed Travis has had a few of those buckets. Compliments of his teammate.
Grad transfer from Stanford.
Preseason first team all SEC.
Travis went down hard. Nearly a walk from A&M. Starks left open. He'll fire. Got it! He's fun to watch. He's got 16. And the Aggies only trail by a nickel.
Is that how you would draw it up?
You just draw it up going in. Closest since it was 21-16 at the 10-minute mark.
Now can A&M out front keep guys in front of them? They've been getting beat off the dribble.
And that happens again.
Again.
Tyler Hero's got 18. He's having a career night scoring. Whoa, circus shot goes. John Walker the third. Anxiety in Rupp.
Confidence for A&M.
And Kentucky turned it over. Tyler Hero traveled. How about that? Globetrotters are going to be here next month. A&M trails by five. They scored the first 10 points of this game.
Pressure now on Mitchell to run the show. Also, he's a jump shooter outside. Flag's been quiet.
Mitchell is blanketed by Ashton Hagans, one of the best defensive players in college basketball. So Flag has his shot rejected by Richards. They'll have eight left on the shot clock. Kentucky 66, Texas A&M 61 at the fifth ranked Kentucky getting all they can handle from a 500 Texas A&M team here at Rupp Arena. Kentucky only three losses on the season, the blowout to Duke to open play, and then a pair of one possession losses on the road at Seton Hall and at Alabama. And Texas A&M, John Sunvold, staying in this game thanks to some circus plays.
Very fortunate on the offensive end, but they have converted. There's confidence going. If they can continue to make a couple defensive stops, what's happened on the offensive end sometimes is almost magic. Looked like a turnover, ends up with three. So there's confidence going. You can see it on the bench. You can see it on their players' faces. Oh, good play from underneath out of bounds.
Another wow. Circus shot, and it falls in for J.J. Chandler.
Out of the timeout, Kentucky caught napping. He comes around the double pick. The freshman Hero gets knocked off.
And you talked about the fact that teenagers sometimes have short attention spans. The Kentucky coaches worked on that play today. They went over it and shoot around, and Tyler Hero was napping coming out of the timeout.
They just came out of a timeout. Underneath out of bounds, you can't give up a layup. On top of that, he fouled, and Chandler's had an unbelievable second half.
He's got 18 total, 12 and a half. 11th meeting as SEC foes. Four of the previous 10 between Kentucky and A&M went to overtime. One to double overtime. A&M back in his zone.
Tom, Kentucky's only really played two close games. They lost both of them, Seton Hall in overtime, and then they lost at Alabama. They were leading that North Carolina game throughout, and Louisville won those easily. They've only had two close games. Didn't handle things down the stretch in either one.
They had to scramble to make it close at the end of that Alabama game,
yep,
as Nebo commits his second personal foul. John Calipari, after the Seton Hall loss, said this is just what we needed. Here's Quickley. Got it. Big time three for Emmanuel Quickley.
Yeah, what an answer right there. Great release, wide open look. Tough enough to step up and take the shot. A&M struggles.
It's Texas A&M turnover. 16th turnover, Starks will return.
Mitchell is solid as a shooter. It's not his job to run the show. That's not what his strength is. Big possessions now each time down the floor for both teams. Matchup zone defense at best.
Chandler on Hero. Took an extra step. Turnover number 17. And if A&M can't pull this thing out on the road, Billy Kennedy's going to lament the sloppy play.
Yeah, too many mistakes. I would say if you talk to Billy and his coaching staff right now, they would love their position when they enter this game. Are we this close with 6:40 left in the ballgame? They lost a close in their opener against Arkansas at home.
That one had 16 ties and 11 lead changes.
And didn't make shots down the stretch. Mm-hmm.
Starks is their biggest offensive threat. He lurks in the far corner.
And Flagg has been quiet, but he's a guy that can explode at any time.
It's his first bucket of the second half. Averaged 31 points a game 2 years ago as a high school senior.
Matchup zone, you better have hands up in a hurry quickly, and Hero are the shooters. Too late.
Hero makes him pay, found the crease.
And there's really two guys you're focusing on when you're in your zone defense against Kentucky with this squad in the lineup. You must get to Hero, and they did not.
Left him alone, but Starks couldn't make him pay. Texas A&M basketball. Starks had a wide open 16-footer.
You're surprised that quickly didn't pick this ball up. It's off his teammate's hands, and I know, but if you have a chance to get it.
You don't leave it to chance if you
right.
have a chance,
no, if you,
right?
If you can just pick it up. But maybe he couldn't.
Tyler Hero has 21 points tonight. His career high is 24. That came in the Louisville game. Starks working on a 16-point night. They switch Travis onto him. And an offensive board. But once again, A&M missed an opportunity.
Yeah, Nebo had one. He could have converted. Good pass.
Travis with a spin and lost it.
I think Mitchell with the great hands knocked it out of Travis's hands.
6-point game with 5 to go.
Tom, you get a little bit of a look what the Aggies are building through this season, though, right?
Mm-hmm.
New faces, continue to get better.
Billy Kennedy lost 3 guys early last year. He said, we're not a program that's built to survive those losses. He said, it's amazing what John Calipari does. Starks gambled, didn't get back, and then are going to foul before the shot. And the officials are going to discuss it. It'll be a blocking foul on A&M. Billy Kennedy can't believe it. Was he in the arc? He was. And that was likely the discussion.
Yep.
So Mekabulu commits his second. Billy Kennedy's point was this. He said, when you're John Calipari, you can recruit to open spots on your roster that are not yet open. Because the recruits know who's going on to the NBA, who's
right,
one and done.
Right.
We can't do that. Even if we get a feeling that a Tyler Davis or DJ Hoger are going to leave, the recruits are like, no, you got a guy in my position.
Right, right.
And that's one of the reasons Texas A&M is in every other year program or has been under Billy Kennedy.
And they bring in guys that will build and make their program better. Good move.
Higgins has a dozen.
I'm going to go back to the last play that Starks made. I've been hard on Starks because, again, I think he's a terrific player as a sophomore. He went for a steal, took himself out of the play, never hustled back.
Yeah.
You're the leader of the squad. I don't care how old you are, you're the leader of this team. You got a chance to win in one of the toughest environments in college basketball. You got a chance. Now you got to make sure you make the right plays on both ends down the stretch.
Shot clock is at 6. Saving a flag. We'll pull for 3. And Kelvin Johnson with the board. Kentucky has a chance to stretch out this lead. Mismatch. P.J. Washington uses muscle. And 1. P.J. Washington, 6'7", 234. John Walker, 6'9", 196. It's a 10-point lead for the Cats. P.J. Washington will be at the line to try to make it an 11-point advantage when we return to Rupp. Well, the Kentucky faithful breathing a little bit easier, but still 3:43 to go, and they're in a dogfight with Texas A&M. It's a 10-point lead for the 18th-ranked Cats. These two teams have met 10 times in SEC play. 4 of those 10 meetings have gone to overtime. 1 went to double overtime. Elson Turner came in here a couple years ago, shot the lights out for A&M.
Had a pretty good night. What do you go for, 44?
Sure, we can look it up. Kentucky leads all time 9-4, and A&M got a win in College Station last year. Kentucky's schedule, by the way, is tougher than anybody else in the league. You got Kansas mixed in right in the middle,
yep.
And their big guy, Udeke Ozebuku's out for the season.
He's out. That changes Kansas for the rest of the year.
But they also have the top 3 teams twice in this unbalanced SEC schedule. Mississippi State twice, Tennessee twice. Florida twice. P.J. Washington at the free throw line. And that Mississippi State team is building something special in Starkville. Elson Turner had 40. That was the 3rd most by an opposing player in Rupp. Starks. Guarded by Higgins. And then they switch. Higgins recovers. Mitchell. Those circus shots that fell 5 minutes ago and now falling off the rim.
You know, and the shots that fell weren't easy looks, and neither are these. So Kentucky's been solid.
What do you think of Ashton Higgins on the defensive end?
I think he's terrific. He's got great feet, great hands. His base is so good. Most guys don't get by him. Great timing of the ball, great feel for when to go for steals, when not to. Strong hands, strong forearms.
Kelvin Johnson lost it. Higgins found it. Nice crossover in the dish. Hero. Kentucky's lead is 11. This is about where it was on the other end of the score for Kentucky at Alabama on Saturday, and they mounted a furious comeback and had a chance to win it. Starks, no. Flag picks it up and fires.
Good timing on your mention of a comeback. They've got to hit shots. Got to find a way to contain on the defensive end. Now they're in the zone.
Kentucky's made 7 of its last 9 field goals. Higgins into the crease. P.J. Washington.
A&M, you want to push, see if you can get her early looks. Nothing there.
Mitchell lost it on the crossover, then committed the foul.
And it was Higgins with his hands.
Yeah.
I don't know if they'll give him a steal, but he knocked that ball loose. And turnover.
Ashton Higgins' hands are huge. They're 9 3/4 inch wide, 8 3/4 inches long. The width is the 4th widest on the team behind the 3 bigs.
He is disrupted and has changed this Kentucky team. Half court trap. easily handled by Kentucky. Good finish.
Wow. John Calipari's been talking to Ashton Hagans about the hockey assists. You don't have to pick up the assist, but set up a guy through another pass, and that's what happened on the Washington dunk.
Yeah, half-court trap, 1-3-1. They handled it well-coached, well-executed. Strong finish by P.J. at the rim.
Hagans commits a foul. It's his first. And Starks will be at the free throw line. ...17 for Starks. Matching his total against Kentucky in the win in College Station last year. Listen, folks, headed out of Rupp already. 1:37 to go. Only an 8-point game.
Maybe they like what they see with Mr. Hagans running the show out front. Handles the pressure easily.
Maybe they just love listening to Tom Leach on the radio. Although our bosses would suggest perhaps they have the ESPN app.
Probably so. Put it on their phone. Make sure it's secure when they're driving.
So here's Hagans in the free throw line.
Are you doing a post-game hit from section 230?
Right.
Are you getting back up there?
I might go see my people. All right. I miss them already. Shirley and Caroline. Hagans has 14.
Pretty solid night for Hagans.
Career high.
8-9 from the foul line, 4 assists, only 1 turnover.
Starks puts it up wide right.
Pretty good effort by A&M. Thought they'd be moving coming in.
That was probably a good sign for Billy Kennedy that he can take back to College Station. So we can have this team on the road and just take care of the basketball. Do a couple things different.
Too many mistakes. Don't get beat off the dribble. Kentucky had too many points in the paint against a, you know, Billy Kennedy's teams are always so well good defensive. But it's a young team. Young guys trying to learn each other, learn how to guard, learn how to help weak side defense. Too many breakdowns.
Coming for Hagans. Kentucky has Vanderbilt Saturday night on the SEC Network. A&M will be at Alabama on Saturday.
So, Tom, if your lead guard, he shoots about 80% now, can handle the basketball, not make mistakes, solid defender. That's what you need, and make free throws down the stretch. Hagans has done all of that tonight.
Hagans, another steal. A breakaway dunk.
Might have got away with a little kick, but guys on defense use everything, and he's still playing, still guarding.
Yeah.
He's not going to let up. Reminds me of the great Arkansas defender, Alvin Robinson, that I played with at San Antonio Spurs.
It must be frustrating, right, face a guy like that?
Defended every day, every minute of practice, never stopped. And he was an all-star because of it.
Hero will pull it out. Less than a second difference between the shot clock and the game clock. Kentucky's going to end even its SEC record.
Good bounce back win after the loss at Alabama. Coaches will always have something to think about, but good win for the players.
Hold on. Game's not quite over yet.
Make sure you get that last second in.
We got a shot clock violation. John Calipari says, my bad. He was telling Ashton Hagans just to throw the ball up, but didn't realize that there would be a shot clock violation as a result. It's about the only thing that has gone wrong, and so they just need to figure out how much time to put back on the clock. I think we just wanted to spend more time together tonight.
Got to make sure we get it all in, Tom. Got it.
Oh! Wait a second. Are we counting that one? We are. And a three to end it. And that's a big shot to some.
That
Let me tell you.
We'll have to take a look and see what that meant.
It meant something, depending on who you're talking to.
What a way to end.
I think Van Pelt might be interested in that finish. Wow. Savion Flagg from halfway to Hazard to throw in this triple. And every second counts from midcourt. He finishes with 13. ...85-74 the final. Kentucky evens its SEC mark to 1-1. A&M draws to 0-2. John Calipari is with John Sumble.
Coach, you know, I mean, conference games aren't easy. And it doesn't matter what records are. And A&M fought hard. What were your thoughts the second half? We had you at halftime.
The Kentucky Office of Highway Safety asks that you make a
we're still,
always wear your
we're so inexperienced, they don't understand that you got to, whatever the game plan is, collectively, one guy can't choose to do what he chooses. It's like a quarterback turning right and the whole team goes left. It's no different. And so we got to work on that. We've got some guys not playing as well as I think they need to play, but we'll work on that. This team is, we're a work in progress. I mean, we went from playing like wow to starting to drift back, and we got to get it back.
Let's go to your point guard, Hagans, who in the last month, 5 weeks, I mean, the emergence changes your team when the other guys come along with it.
Yeah, and he's shooting the ball better. People are finding out. People don't think he can shoot. He can shoot. But he is so used to getting shots for everybody, getting in that lane. I love the elbow pull-up. I loved all the made free throws. It shows that, all right, he's capable.
And what a rare player that can really do it from the defensive end, really full court. He didn't take a playoff even at 15 seconds left.
Right, and Emmanuel played well today. See, they're two different kind of guards. One's more of an attack guard. The other's more of a drifter who can make threes, who can come off screens. If you dribble handoff and don't play him, he can make shots. He defended pretty well today.
I know you haven't seen the film of this, but what do you think your biggest keys are getting better in the next few weeks?
You know, the way we started Alabama in this game was about similar. The second half, the way we started Alabama in this game is similar. So either I've got to do something or change lineups. There's something that's got to happen so that in league play, like you said, you can't be down 12-2. And think, okay, we're going to beat this team by 50. Wait, you're down 12-2. So we got work to do. But, again, I like my team. I like these kids. They're really trying. We just got a lot of work to do.
Hey, good win. Good luck Saturday.
John Calipari and his Wildcats get a 1-1 in conference play. He talked about his guards. Here's one who had a great night as we take a look at tonight's good hands play. Brought to you by Allstate. Tyler Hero, one bucket away from his career high. The freshman finished with 21. He did it from behind the arc. He did it on his way in the paint. He got his teammates involved, and he was a zone buster for Kentucky tonight. Hero hit 3 of 7 from deep. And Kentucky, despite falling behind 12-2 early, as John Calipari talked about, fought back for the victory. Your final score, Kentucky over Texas A&M, 85-74. More basketball to come tonight, but first, let's swing by Charlotte as we catch in with Peter Burns and Pat Bradley.
Factually correct.